And I think I was just crossing off all the questions that I don't have to ask you. But one of them, like, you know, since we're on a college campus right now, and so many people here are part of the Boston College Theater Department, I'm sure. I mean, you've given us, like, you know, 50 or more examples of how to engage an audience and theater as a civic space. But I'm wondering, you know, if we can pick your brain in terms of, like, how to do that on a college campus. Like, I know ART is part of Harvard, but I wonder, was there anything that worked particularly well, like, with the Harvard community, with the student community, sure. Or anything you think that's applicable here? Mm-hmm. And when I was thinking of, you know, who's part of the community here, it's not just students, it's also faculty, it's parents, it's staff. You know, so, yeah, so like which one of those, or do you have something else in mind that would be specifically for the Harvard community?
Sure. Well, you know, I think being on a campus is like a mini universe. I mean, that's how I think about Harvard. So we are making work for the greater Boston community, for people who travel to Boston CCRT. But one huge constituent of our operation is Harvard. And that has been such a driver for all of us. Every time I'm considering what show to go, I'm thinking, oh, the Divinity School will love this. You know, actually, we had a good partnership with the Divinity School of Miss Uganda. Because Jonathan Walton, who's a professor at Harvard, who's the minister on campus, you know, this issue of what does it mean to be gay and be Christian? And what does it mean to get asked to leave your choir because you're gay? And so I went right to Jonathan. He had the whole cast over to his house. There were all these kind of events. So in a way, it goes fundamentally to this question of what are we going to program at ART? I start thinking, who are the professors? Where are the partnerships for dialogue? And now it's gotten to the point where we start to have conversations and we don't even know what we're going to do. So I'll give you two examples. And I just want to encourage you, that if you're making art on campus, to reach out. Yes, you're thinking about your department, your theater department, but to reach out across your university. So we went to meet Michelle Williams, who's the new dean of the School of Public Health and Art, the first African-American woman to be a dean of Harvard. Read about her, I wanted to meet her. And that's what I did. I took my artistic thing and just said, I want to meet you. It was actually coming up to Anna DeGerson's show, so I wanted to have everybody to know about Anna's show. And over the course of the conversation, she said, you know, Diane, one of the biggest issues we face in public health is stigma and shame. It's one of the biggest barriers to public health. And she said, it would be great if we could partner and think about how you as a theater could help us address these issues of stigma and shame. I don't know what we're going to do yet. You know, that's purpose. That's a purpose for us as a theater. The other one was Dan Schrag, who runs the Center for the Environment. He came to my office.
Well, that's like putting you on the
spot. I know. It took a while. You know, now I've worked very hard for 8 years to really make the theater feel like it's a center for Harvard, not just a theater. I often call it, my aspiration is that ART should be the dramaturg for the university. Dan Schrag came and he said, you know, this was 3 years ago. It's like gone like this now because that was before the Paris talks, so things, you know, felt a little more optimistic now, not so much anymore. But he said, no one is listening. You know, he runs the center, scientists, panels, discussions, and he said to me, I think it's because people don't know how to imagine the future. We're so caught in the pressing concerns of our lives and present that people just don't have the capacity or the interest or the wherewithal to really imagine the future. And if we can get people to imagine and live in and empathize the future, maybe then we'll get off our butts on climate change. She's really climate change. And he said things like, you know, would we really remember the American Dust Bowl if it wasn't for Grace Wrath? You know, we had Hurricane Sandy, devastating, kind of forgotten about it. Now, you know, so sometimes it's works of art that help us remember, experience, feel, or even imagine the future. So then we said, great, let's commission together. So we have now a commissioning partnership with the Center for the Environment, where we're working with playwrights and commissioning them to create theater pieces around issues related to climate change. So that's one other outcome. But it's a very fertile environment, and I would just encourage you, you know, to also, it's also a really basic thing, like marketing your shows. I mean, I know there are people out there who probably are interested in, you know, how do you get people to see your shows? That's another way to get people to see your shows. If you have these partnerships with, not just getting, you know, your theater friends, you're making it an important event on the campus. And they've never thought about why you're doing this. All of a sudden, they need to be there because they're affiliated, it's an issue they believe in, they were part of a discussion. They're part of the discussion after the show, or not, they're part of the discussion that leads up to the creation of the show. Even better.
And this question I'm pretty obsessed about, I think about it all the time, is, you know, so often in theater we hear that basically we're just preaching to the choir. And so I think, you know, one of the things that you showed in your music presentation was sort of what else we can do with and to and for the choir other than preach to them. You know, like you really sort of activated them to them. But I mean, do you feel like any of those productions, there were people outside the choir that came to see the productions, or for, you know, do you think about that, and do you think about what kind of bring people that aren't part of that choir?
Sure. I mean, it's a huge discussion, especially, you know, post-November. You know, two stories related to Emily Versman's show. I sort of thought, you know, everybody's going to get Emma's show. People's Republic of Cambridge, they're going to be there, they're going to embrace the show. And it was so interesting in those talk backs, because I sat in a lot of them. And you go to one of those discussion groups, and now talk backs, especially, and I can't tell you the number of people who would enter that talk back and say, I don't relate to this, I don't know how to relate to this. And then there would be an African-American PhD student in the same discussion, and he would say, well, I've got arrested 3 times in the last 2 years, like around the block here. And that person said, what do you mean? And I said, well, I looked the way I look, and I didn't have my Harvard ID on me, and I got arrested, because you're supposed to have your Harvard ID on you when you're on campus. And they were like, what? And all of a sudden, the problem that looked like it was Baltimore, you know, not Cambridge, came right home to, like, what's going on in our 5 block radius of this theater. Another anecdote when Anna DeVere's the show, I really felt like, well, you guys, we've got to get a diverse audience to see this. And I focused, we went really crazy with community partners. You know, it was like 5 times the number of people we subsidized to come to the theater on the virtual show. But I was interested in the Harvard student body, because I thought the Harvard students need to see this. This is like a service we're providing on ART. And I went to Jonathan Wallaby, this amazing minister. We have a relationship with him, which I love. We have a relationship with the minister of Harvard. I said, Jonathan, how am I going to get diverse students to see the show? And he gave me this amazing piece of advice. He said, okay, don't target the black students. He said, go to the athletic student. He said, go get student groups where there are diverse students represented on the group and get them to the theater. And I thought, okay, that's, wow, I would never have thought of that. So I called Bob Scalise, director of athletics at Harvard. I would never call Bob Scalise. But at a party, that came in handy. And I said, we're doing the show, and I feel like we're doing the show so that everyone at Harvard can take advantage of this. Do you remember what was going on last summer? And how we were all feeling? I mean, Dallas, all, I mean, it was like every day you wake up and there would be another trauma happening in America. And I said, we happen to be doing the show. We're talking about criminal justice and race in America. Harvard students should be invited to be part of this. I explained how the discussions. Paused, waited. He said, I get it. We're going to make this happen. The football team came. The men's and women's basketball team came. The soccer team came. These were groups that had never been to the ART. And I remember, and I did, and they all came in their jackets and ties. And I remember the night that the football team was there, and there were certain of those team members who were laying on the street corner, and they said, like, oh my God, I feel very awakened to, like, issues I never thought about, and I'm thinking about my teammates, and maybe what they go through a whole different way. So that was a moment of, you know, getting out of bubble. You know, so those were ways in which, but you don't know how to do it. Every show kind of gives you an opportunity to think about it, leads to ideas, leads to experiments, and then you're on the post.
So I'm going to force you to remember November.
Yeah.
2016. Where were you in season planning, and then did anything change as a result?
You may have noticed we haven't announced our next season. We just announced our first show, and there are many reasons for that. You know, we're juggling a lot of big projects, and we're just waiting for certain pieces to fall into place. But I was reflecting on this with Ann Wilbur, our teacher, journey teacher from Columbia, actually on Tuesday to talk to the students there. And I said, part of the reason why I think we're late announcing our season is we've been two things. One, kind of waiting and holding and just unable to press go like it's business as usual. Like ever since November, it's been, we can't just proceed with it. Well, this is what we do. This is how we do it. This is what we're, it's been this day by day encounter with how should we be responding. And I don't, I'm not here to say we have the answer. And, you know, one thing we did do was we created response nights at Omar. It's very hard to respond quickly in the theater because you're programming in advance, you're committing artists' schedule, everything's a year out, 2 years out. So how do you make room for something that's going to pop up? So the space we have for that is Omar. So we had a response night in the middle of the summer, and we actually went to Dallas, and then we knew, we were like, let's have a response night at Omar for a week after the election. Not knowing the outcome, but knowing that we need to be discussion, whatever we have. You know, so that was one way we shifted kind of priorities to go along. And then the other thing, I think we're just all, it's been very hard to function, frankly. You know, I've just been very aware of the staff, you know, the way of controls, just about how to proceed, certain staff members feeling, certain staff are very scared. You know, how do we respond, react, continue? So we will have a season announcement in a couple of weeks. You know, we had a play that was going to come in December because of the subject matter. Frankly, it's so relevant it got snatched up straight to Broadway. So we lost one because the pressing topic was so relevant they decided to jump a stop in our theater. So that was one outcome. But I think it's going to be an ongoing process of response, an ongoing response to the world we live in. And I want to share one more thing. The day after the election, I woke up with a feeling, going back to your bubble question, of really feeling like I have failed as an artistic director. That was my dominant feeling, and I moved beyond that. Because I think, you know, after the election, I think the day after the election, there was this feeling like all of America wanted this to happen, except for you few people in those elite bubbles. I think we moved beyond that now. As data has come in, we know it's not all of America. That's not quite the narrative. That's not quite the truth, even though it's very hard to figure out the truth these days. But that first feeling was like, how did we miss this? And I remember feeling, okay, I'm so proud we did an endorsement. We have transcripts coming, but I was like, where was the play about the people who felt that they needed to vote for Trump because of their lives, because of their economic duress, because of what they're going through? You know, I felt like, why haven't I been attuned to that narrative? And that narrative is as important as marginalized voices. That's another form of marginalized voices. Complicated, but that was my opinion.
I want to give you guys an opportunity to ask questions.
Okay. First of all, thank you so much for coming. I'm thrilled to hear you speak. I, as a undergraduate who is a rising senior, I'm sort of looking at the world and kind of like, what am I going to do with these skills that I've acquired at the theater department? And so I was kind of curious what your journey was after leaving undergraduate school and making the decision to continue in the arts and go to graduate school and do whatever you think that means. what that journey was like for you and how you kind of made those decisions.
Sure. I'll try to keep it brief.
Sure.
But I graduated Harvard and I was going to drive across the country in my brother's car with my now husband and we were going to go to Alaska and like, see America. I'd read a lot of Robert Cole in college to experience America. And the car broke. Start. Literally, like, stick shift. I went there one day, I had to be towed, plans, busted. Literally, like, now what do I do? A friend said, oh, you know, Circle Square has a summer acting program. I quickly auditioned for that, got into that. Met someone there, and she said, oh, no, there's this new school starting called the New Actors Workshop. It's an acting program, first year, that immediately attracted me. You always have to see, you know, what attracts you. So I was like, I love things that start. So I mean, like, ground level or something. And it was a school that was being founded by George Morrison, a method teacher, Paul Silves, the great master of improvisation, son of Viola Spolman, who wrote improvisation theater, and Mike Nichols, the film director. And I thought, okay, that sounds cool. I auditioned, got into that, spent 2 years training as an actor. There were only actors in school. There were no dramaturgs, playwrights, anyone else. So as a result, without realizing it, I was getting all my directing training. I sat in master class with Mike Nichols every Wednesday, 4 hours. You could bring in anything. Shakespeare, Neil Simon, Tennessee Williams, anything you wanted. And you present your scene for Mike, and like a master, you'd sit there. And you were the actor, so you had to cut the scene, you had to stage it, you had to pick your props, you had to make it walking, and then you tried to act it. And he would talk to you as actors about your choices and about the story. About the event, and he'd tell anecdotes from his life, and I just soaked it up. And to this day, the bedrock of my directing has come from my Nichols and Paul Silves, who was a great mentor. So here's my story. This is a long story, what you go through in life, but this is important. That school ended, and two things happened to me. I'm going to tell you these two stories. So, I got an agent. And you know, I was like, whoa, I got an agent. And I got photos taken, and I went to my agent, and she looked at them, and she said, you're so unusual looking. I was so excited. Like, what are you? Are you Greek? You could be Italian? Tell me, no judgment, I don't want to know. And I was a very eager young actor, and I said, well, actually, I'm half Japanese, and my father's German. And then she said, no wonder your photos look like you're a Vietnamese bar girl. We'll have to retake them. And I was like, okay. Eager young actor. They sent me back. They paid for the redo. Because, you know, I was like a young, struggling actress. They curled my hair. And I curled my hair like this. Took these pictures. I went and got 800 of them made. And those were the days where you got a service number. You guys were a service number. But they, no cell phones. So you had a service. You paid $35 a month for a service. It was like 212-666-3535. And that was the number that went on your headshots. And what would you do? Like, embarrassingly, humiliating, you call your service. And you call your service and you say, any messages? Because if you were getting an audition, it would go to your service. And I don't think I once had a message on my service. I mean, it was a little like, no messages, and then you'd sit.
And it was a human being.
It was a human being. That's what you You sit at your temp job, you're like, an hour and a half has passed, maybe I should call my service. Any messages? No messages. It was like total humiliation, like 10 times a day calling your service. So I get these photos, 800 postcards made with my curly hair and my number on it. And I remember seeing them. And I looked at them, and I thought, this is not why I wanted to move here. And I put these postcards in a shopping bag. And I never took them. It was like one of those moments where you thought, this was not why I was on the planet to do theater, was to follow this. Now that's not to say I don't worship at the feet of actors. You know, to be an actor, oh my God, bless you. It's hard enough to be a director. You know, the actor's life is perhaps even harder. I wanted to create, I wanted to be an activist, I wanted to make things happen. And so I started staging plays with my acting classmates in abandoned spaces in New York City. So, you know, community gardens, plots of land that were taken over by the community. I walked in once, my first project. I said to someone gardening, I said, this looks like a little amphitheater. Do you ever do anything with it? She said, no, no, no. You have to go talk to, the board meets in that apartment building once a month. You have to talk to them. I had this idea of doing Shakespeare, because a joke happens, and you know what I was like, we're going to do Shakespeare, we're going to do 12th Night, and this little perfect amphitheater. I had to go to the meeting of the board, and I pitched my whole idea. I said, it's going to be free, it's going to be for the community. And they said, fine, one rule. You can't stop anyone from gardening. I was like, great, I get it. If I'm doing my job well, the person will put down their shovel. That's my mission. And I started directing plays. I started directing plays at the school. I asked to keep the school open at night if I could do a show in the school. I was acting in the shows and then directing them, and I stopped acting, I started directing. And then when I left the Actors Workshop, this is my last bit of the answer to this, we had one of these moments with classmates that you have, which you're all going to have, 2 a.m. in the morning, you know, with a beer in your hand. Where are you going to be? What do you want to do in your life? And we ran around the circle, and someone said, oh, I want to go to Hollywood. I want to go on Broadway. I want to get a soap opera. We were all actors. And it came around to me. This was 1990. And I kid you not, I said, well, I want to be Robert Bruceding and run the American Repertory here. All my actor friends were like, what's that? What are you talking about? We had all just finished acting training. We were all prepared to enter the field and try to get an acting job. And I remember saying it, because I think I had come out of Harvard, and I remember seeing those shows in the 80s at ART, Robert Wilson, Philip Glass, Sarah Marge, Tim Moore, New York, a lot of theater that just blew my mind. It was an example. And I thought, what could be more incredible than to be writing that theater? And then yeah, I went on a long journey, founded a theater company in rural Wisconsin, did that for 5 years, then decided I had to get directing training, went to Columbia, met Andre, that led to other opportunities. But I'll never, when I got this job, I told the story, I said, no one's gonna believe me, but I said this like 25 years. But I say that to young people. I say, sometimes you have to say it. My mentor, Anne Bogart, calls it the violence of articulation. Mm-hmm. You just say, in 5 years, I will be. Mm-hmm. Now, like, I think I might want to be made notes. Commit to it. Write it down. It can change tomorrow. You don't have to stick to it. But sometimes, and my people said that. Because a lot of students will say, how do you get to Hollywood? How do we? You say, one baby step after the next baby step. Just start stepping, and you will get it. Brief answer.
Another question?
Way over.
So you've talked a lot about where the ART has been, what you've done with them, with the new president and his vision for the NEA and for the arts world. Where do you see, I mean, you can speak to your experience specifically at the ART, but even on a broader scale, where do you see the art world going in the next 4 years? Or where do you see, how do you see this current administration really impacting the art world?
You know, some friends I have who work in Washington, you know, there's this question, like, is this really going to all go away? You know, is the NEA going to completely eradicate it? Is he going to follow through? Is our president going to follow through on all these proposed cuts? Is Congress going to follow, you know, is Congress going to dream like this? I think for the ART, we have depended on money from the NEA throughout our entire history. Transcripts was funded for the grant from the NEA. And when we got the grant, you can bet we got hate mail. And there were letters saying how dare the NEA support a show about trans people. Would we, as an institution, survive without the NEA? I think we would figure it out. Other institutions know. But I think what's more pertinent about what this discussion has unearthed is sort of the culture war. Like, to me, that's more what's going on in our country. Like, this idea that culture can just be, like, swept away. It doesn't matter. It's not necessary. And just, you know, from those quotes I read you, there was a time in America where our presidents understood that culture is the vehicle for reading our history, for creating understanding, and I think now more than ever, when we're barraged with information, I don't know how you feel, but I can barely function. I do it to myself. I get in bed, I turn my phone, like, what happened today? And you start reading these articles, and you look at videos, and you're kind of numbed. That's why I said I feel like we're in a fog, because you get overwhelmed, and you feel like, how do I react? How do I make sense of this? Rather than it being galvanizing, I find it numbing. But I'm addicted to it, like reading all the different happenings and the next development and the next outrage. So I think it's really important, imperative for artists as one constituent piece of our society to engage with what's going on in our country in a way where we're not numbed, you know, where we're actually invited into a dialogue where we're happy to come together. I think it's basic that is that in many ways. That theaters can be collective spaces. We don't have enough collective spaces. This is Naomi Klein's says this. Collective spaces for democracy to happen. We're so segregated. It's like you only get the news you want to get because you're able to get the news you like. You only get the TV shows that you like because everything's catered to your taste. So this idea that the theater, if we could do it and not just be a bubble, we could be a collective space where people could feel safe. That's the outcome. Where people could be safe and where we could actually engage audiences on an emotional level. I came across another quote of Susan Sontag that says, thinking is a form of feeling, and feeling is a form of thinking. You know, I just read that once, and I thought that really resonated with me, that we have to find a way to engage our hearts and our minds and our bodies in collective spaces. So if the theater can play a role in that, we should be better doing that in the next
one more. Oh no,
I've
got to
find
it out.
When you get an idea and then you make it into the action, seeing and
knowing. So the question was, am I surprised when I get an idea and I make it into production?
When it works.
When it works. Oh my goodness. More surprised when, you know, it's not surprised, kind of like, you know, worried when it's not working. You know what, what I want to answer is that, you know, a lot of people have asked me, like, oh, you know, you have such a director with such a big vision. And I've always felt like, what are you talking about? I've always felt like I have no vision. Yeah. Those European directors or tour directors, they have vision. You know, I've never felt of myself as a director with a vision. I always think about questions. And it's a good place to end, because I always feel my job as the director is to ask the question, and to ask, frankly, a big enough question so that it can include and engage and provoke people to the deepest possible level. And I had a Robert Woodruff, my predecessor in ART, he was my teacher at Columbia. I remember he used to say, if your work is banal, you come in and show work to him in the studio. If your work's banal, you probably haven't asked a big enough question. And that's stuck with me. So I've always said, you know, you don't have to young artists, especially young artists, you don't have to have the answer. In fact, you really shouldn't have the answer. The whole process is about discovery, but you have to have the question. And you have to have passion, and you have to have enthusiasm, and you have to have crazy drive, and you have to sense the potential. That's a pure vocal thing. You have to sense the potential. That's what I do. And you have to trust. You have to sense the potential. You have to trust it, and then you've got to keep pointing to it. But I rely on everyone to get me there. And what you do as the director is you really just have to keep everybody climbing up the hill, and nobody wants to anymore. You're halfway up, and people are like, I'm tired, I don't want to do this anymore, I'm hungry, why did you make me come up and out? You know, your job as the director is to say, no, remember that question, remember that potential up there? Guess what, and it's very liberating. I want to say this to the young directors in the room. Do you have directing students here?
Yeah.
Yes, but okay, great. It's very liberating to share that with your your company. You know, so many times you feel terrified, you're like, I have to have an answer. I have to know what to say. The most liberating thing is to walk in a room. Yes, you have to have done your research. Yes, you have to be prepared. Yes, you have to be full of passion. You have to be authentic. But to say, here's the challenge. Here's the challenge today. Here's the challenge tomorrow. Here's the challenge where we are in the process. This is the work for the day. I'm not sure how we answer it, but this is what we are all going to engage in. Because you're actually eliciting everybody's creativity. And that's very powerful. You know, people tend to go in a room, and what I say on day one of every rehearsal, sort of segue from the question, but what I say on every first day of rehearsal is I always say, I'm going to come with an idea, and I expect you, actor, to come with an idea, you, stage manager, you, playwright, but together, as a group, we're going to find a third idea that is better than either of our teams. And immediately everybody goes, okay, let's do that. Right? And it's not about ego, it's not about, my idea, your idea, a fight. It's about more kind of a common quest to something bigger than either of us. So I'm usually just in a state of a lot of chaos, actually. If you have to be able to tolerate a lot of chaos, you have to be able to be in a room and let like something happen. So I have a high tolerance for that kind of chaos, because I sort of have my eye on where I think we're going. I just never know how we're going. So it always amazes me when we get there. So anyway, thank you.
Thank you.